We want to welcome you out this morning to Madison. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. Amen. We are here to have an appointment with Jesus Christ. For he says in his word, "For it is the will of my Father that those who look upon the Son and believe in him shall inherit eternal life, and I will raise him up in that last day." Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Welcome. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to invite all the boys and girls of all ages to come up for our children's story. And on your way, if you'd please collect those $20 bills along the way to bring them up for our children's offering. Well, good morning, everyone. I'd like to tell you a story today that takes place in a kingdom far, far away from here. And this kingdom is ruled by a king whom everybody loves and adores because he takes time to get to know everybody who lives in his kingdom, even those that live in the farthest reaches of the kingdom up on the highest hills. Because everyone who lives in this kingdom knows that there's a man who lives at the top of the highest hill, and they just call him simply the Hermit. He lives by himself. He doesn't take care of his home. He lets his land get overgrown, and no one ever comes to visit him. Well, the king knows, I need to go meet this hermit. I need to get to know him a little bit better. And so he sets off. One day, the hermit is outside, just sitting, moping around his house like he does every day, and he hears a noise. Clip-clop, clip-clop, clip-clop. And he wonders, well, someone must be lost. No one ever comes to see me. And he looks down his road, and he sees far off this beautiful white horse. Clip-clop, clip-clop, clip-clop. And it gets closer and closer, and he realizes that on this horse is somebody of royalty, and he realizes all of a sudden, this must be the king. And the king comes up next to the hermit, and he looks over the land, and at the top of this hill, he can see the entire kingdom. And he says, Mr. Hermit, I've been traveling a very long time to get here. Can I trouble you for a glass of water? Oh, no. The hermit wasn't ready for this. His well has been overgrown. He can't even get to the water. And he thinks about it, and all of his cups in his house are dirty. Nothing is clean. And as he's thinking about this, the king turns to him and says, well, Mr. Hermit, I will come back and visit you again. And he rides away. The hermit all of a sudden realizes, I have to be ready for the king to come back. And so he goes and he cleans out his well. He gets all the weeds and everything that's overgrown to make sure there's fresh water. He goes into his house and he cleans all of his cups to make sure that he's ready for when the king comes back. A couple of days later, he hears that familiar sound. Clip-clop, clip-clop, clip-clop. And he looks and it's the king. The king has come back. And the king comes up and says, Mr. Hermit, can I trouble you for a glass of water? Oh, the hermit is very proud, has a big smile on his face, runs into his house, pours a nice cold glass of water, hands it to the king, and the king drinks it down. And the hermit is so proud of himself. And then the king turns to the hermit and says, Mr. Hermit, I'm also very hungry. Can I trouble you for a meal? Oh, no, the hermit wasn't ready for this. He looks at his garden. His garden is covered with weeds. He thinks about what's in his house. His dining room table is not ready for a king to sit there. And all of his dishes and forks and spoons are all dirty as well. And as he's thinking about this, the king turns to him and says, Mr. Hermit, I will come back again soon. And turns and rides away. Oh, the hermit has to get to work, so he cleans out his garden. He goes into his home and he wipes off the table, cleans all of his dishes and his silverware. And he has to also make sure that there's still water ready for the king when he comes back. A couple days later, he's out in his garden making sure all the food is ready, and he hears a sound. Clip-clop, clip-clop, clip-clop. Do you guys know what it was? How did you know? It was the king, that's right. The king had come back, and the king asks him for a glass of water, and he drinks his water, and he says, can I trouble you for a meal? Oh, the hermit is ready for the meal, so he takes him inside. The dining room table is ready. He pours some stew, and they sit down and enjoy this meal. And after they eat, the king says, well, you know what, Mr. Hermit? I've traveled a long way, and I'm actually pretty tired. Can I trouble you for a rest in your guest room? Oh, no, the hermit wasn't ready for that either. All of his sheets were dirty, and the bed. No one had ever come to visit the hermit. His bed wasn't ready for a king to sleep in. And as he's thinking, the king says to him, well, thank you, Mr. Hermit. I'll come again soon. Oh, now the hermit had to make sure there was clean water, there was food on the table, and he had to get his bed and his sheets all clean and ready for the king to come back. And so a couple days later, do you know what he heard? What did he hear? Clip-clop, clip-clop, clip-clop. That's right, the king had come back again. So he gives him a glass of water. He goes inside and they eat a beautiful meal. And the king says, you know, Mr. Hermit, I'm very tired. Can I have a rest in your guest room? And the hermit says, of course, Mr. King, and takes him to his guest room to take a little rest. You know, the king came and visited the hermit many, many times. And the people of the land no longer called the hermit just the hermit, but they called him a friend of the king. You know what, boys and girls? We're also waiting for our king to return. And we have a choice to make. We can either sit back and do nothing like the hermit used to do before he knew the king and let everything get overgrown and just sit there and wait. Or we can make sure that our home and everything that we have is ready for the king. We can do that by listening to our parents and by telling other people about the king, Jesus, that we know about. So I hope that you choose to tell others about Jesus so they can also be ready for the king to come back. All right, you may go back to your seats.
Happy Sabbath, church. I'd like to invite all the deacons to come up for offering. How many of us have subscription services? I probably wouldn't even have to ask. I'm sure every person here, at least one person in your household, to have some type of subscription service. In 2019, a survey basically was done that says that average Americans actually spend over $200 per month on subscription services. I have a very large one that I can't cancel. It's the SNC Corporation. It's actually Spouse and Children Corporation. I can't cancel the subscription service. It's plaguing people across America. Hundreds of men and women are suffering because of these subscription services. Joking. Netflix, Hulu, all these things that you have, ESPN, we subscribe to these things, but are we subscribing to God? And that's the question we have to ask ourselves, because subscriptions are going up, what we're giving on a monthly and weekly basis, but subscribing, tithes, offering, those different things are declining across America in the local churches. So we actually have basically Adventist giving, where you actually can do it online. It can be on a regular basis. You don't have to think about it. It actually increases 32% of our actually giving when you actually do have that ability to give online. So I just want to ask you, are you subscribing your talents? Are you subscribing your time and your tithes and your offering to God? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this offering that's going to our church budget. And whatever people are able to give, bless it, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Never disconnected, no, no. His arms, I feel protected. There's no place and I'd rather be. Oh,
prayer time, church. And at this time, we want to do something a little bit different. If you feel so inclined to come down front, I want to encourage you to do so. I don't know if you've ever been compelled by anything. Perhaps you have wronged your spouse and hurt their feelings, or you've hurt your children's feelings, or you have made a big mistake and you felt compelled to make it right. You felt compelled to apologize or to speak about what you may have done. There's a story of a prostitute who came to a home where Jesus was. And this prostitute had this reputation that preceded her. Everyone knew what she was about. Everyone knew what she had done with her life. But she didn't care because she felt compelled to get to the Savior. Sometimes when you feel the weight of your sin and the weight and the burden on your shoulders, sometimes all you got left is to get up and come to Jesus. So this morning, if you feel compelled to bring your broken spirit before the Lord, your questions, your pain, your challenges, I want to invite you to make a move from the pew to come down front. As the prostitute begins to come forward, they begin to whisper, "Why is Jesus allowing this sinner to get so close to him? Doesn't he know who she is? Doesn't he care what this looks like?" But she didn't care because she had felt this inner magnetism. She's compelled to get to her Savior. And she goes down onto her knees and her tears are falling and the pain is coming from her eyes and she begins to wash his feet. She uses the perfume from her alabaster box, something that is extremely expensive, because she wants him to understand, this is all I have, and I'm bringing my broken spirit to you. I don't care what people think. I have an appointment with you. And what those people didn't understand is that Jesus had an appointment with her. Because she had a broken spirit. Her pride was gone. Her ego was gone. She needed healing in that moment. She needed forgiveness in that moment. What people think didn't matter. So we're talking to our Savior this morning. And if you feel compelled, please join us down front. Let us pray. Father God, Lord, we thank you for being the incredible God that you are. Lord, it is in your infinite mercy, in your infinite wisdom, that you even placed breath in our lungs this morning. Lord, you love us enough to not allow us to perish while we were yet far off from you. And you have been waiting on someone who is not concerned with what it looks like to humble themselves and pray and to seek your face. Well, here we are, Lord. Lord, we bring to you our shortcomings. We bring to you, Lord, our mistakes. Lord, we bring to you our tears. Lord, many of us are simply interceding for those that we love, our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, our loved ones, the strangers. We bring them to your feet in the most humble way that we know how. Lord, and as we lay at your feet, Lord, I ask that you would forgive each and every person in this room this morning. Lord, because your word says that you draw near to those who are of a broken spirit and a contrite heart. So, Lord, some of us have decided that we're not happy with you and we're not satisfied with where our lives may be or what you have withheld from us. And so there's a wall between us. But right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just humble ourselves and say, not thy will, not our will, but thy will be done. Lord, anything that is in us, anything that is in us that is not like you, we bring it to your feet and we ask for forgiveness. And we ask for mercy. And we wash your feet with our tears. And we plead the blood of Jesus over our lives right now. Because when it is all said and done, it is not your will that anyone should perish. We will not waste this opportunity to have this appointment with you and you alone. Thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. And we celebrate that we have had this time, this morning, to be made new, to be made whole, to be made clean in the precious and mighty name of Jesus. Let everyone say amen and amen.
Good morning, family. It's good to see all of you here. It's a little bit chilly this morning, but you know what? The sun is out. The sun is out. You can use that metaphorically, you can use that literally, but the sun is out this morning. I'm so glad that each one of you are here. As most of you should be aware by this point, we are continuing our Black History Month series at Madison Campus, and we are delighted today to welcome to our pulpit Pastor Lola Moore Johnston. I first met Pastor Johnston as part of the Imagine Nashville initiative, and I immediately knew this was somebody that I would love to see preach here someday. And so I am really happy that Pastor Johnston has agreed to come down here for this Sabbath. She's the senior pastor at the Woodbridge Seventh-day Adventist Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. Today she's joined by her husband, Keith, who's here. Keith, we recognize the sacrifice that spouses of pastors have to make so often, and we are so happy that you were able to make this trip and be here in support and be a part of this celebration today. We know that God is going to say something special through you today, Pastor Johnston, and we are honored that you would choose to worship with us and bring God's word to us today. Thank you all, church family, for being here today as well. God has a gift that he wants to give you, and the only question is whether you'll put your hand out to accept that gift.
Boom, boom. Ooh. Boom, boom. Faith, I know I'll carry on.
how many can testify it is well with my soul? We want to thank the choir for such a wonderful number of renditions. Thank you. I am always excited to come to Music City because anytime you come here, you know that wherever you go, the music will be right. So we want to say thank you. And I want to give a shout out to my sister who actually sang Tori Kelly and actually held it up. Great job. Great job. So I want to say thank you to Pastor Wetmore for the opportunity to be here during this Black History Month. We know that it is a conversation that needs to be had, but that is very sensitive. And so thank you for trusting me with being here with your congregation today. I'm also, as a pastor, sensitive to the time. So although Pastor Wetmore has assured me I can take all the time I need, I have that barometer in me too to say the train has to run on time, so I won't keep you long. For our time together, I'd like to direct you to the book of Psalms, and we'll read together from chapter 27, just two verses, verses 13 and 14. For our reading, I'll be reading from the King James Version, two verses that may be familiar to you. That is, again, Psalm chapter 27, verses 13 and 14. They read this way. I would have lost heart, lest I'd believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Today, I'd like to speak from the subject, This Far by Faith. This Far by Faith. Let's pray together. God, we are grateful for the opportunity to share your word. As we open your word, we open our hearts and pray, speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. We need to hear from you. We need a word from you. So again, speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. This Far by Faith. As I reflect on what is called the Black experience, there is a quality that stands out for me. That quality has a name, which is resilience. I've been doing some studies around the quality of resilience, and by definition, resilience is the quality of a thing, a substance, or a person to endure stress and retain their shape, to not get bent out of shape. When we think about that quality, it is a quality that we all need. Would you agree? We all need to be able to endure hard times, to endure stress, to endure things that stretch us, and to retain our shape. So as I thought about the subject for today, I asked God to give me a word picture, something that I could show that would help me to relay to you what I mean by resilience. And God reminded me of this. Every woman here who has ever worked out or done anything of stress that required for your hair to be restrained knows what this is. There are some gentlemen who have had long hair who also know what this is. I realize that there are husbands like mine who know what this is because when I lose mine, I ask my husband where mine is. It is a hair tie. This hair tie was one that God blessed me to find, you'll see that it is a bit larger than normal hair ties. Because of the style that I have here, I needed something that was bigger than the normal hair tie, something that wouldn't break when I put it under stress for my bun. Amen. And so I found this hair tie. It is meant for being stretched further than normal hair ties. And every time I stretch it, it has a magical quality. It goes right back into shape. And when we think of resilience, this is exactly what we're describing. That a person or a thing will go through experiences that stretch them. And rather than falling apart, rather than breaking, they get right back into shape. Wouldn't it be great to have a quality that allows you to go to work and to deal with the boss who consistently puts things on your desk late and asks you to produce them in double time, and still smile and retain your Christianity? Wouldn't it be great to have a quality that helps you to deal with that, what would you say, spouse and children tax? To look at your bank account, which is being asked to move to unimaginable lengths, and still have your shape. But we realize in our society today that many people are lacking that quality. It causes us to harm ourselves and to harm others. It causes us to break out of relationship. It causes us not to keep our covenants to one another, yea, even causes us not to stay in our churches, because when we are stretched, we break. We are stretched. We go off. When we are stretched, we don't know where to reach. And I think that our text for today has something to say about how we can develop or to actually take on the ability to be resilient. It is, we believe, David who is writing here in Psalm 27. And from a historical perspective, we understand that David is in one of two scenarios. He is either running from Saul, who wants to take his life, or he is running from his son Absalom, who also wants to take his life. You would think about it, and if I were on the run, if I were a fugitive, if I believed that my life would be taken, I wonder what I would say. I would probably be trying to figure out what safe places I could go to. I would try to figure out how I could protect myself. I might be belly aching or afraid. I might be crying out to God, trying to figure out how I got in this position. But it is interesting to me to see what David had to say as he was a fugitive of one of these two people. The Bible tells us in 27:1 that his words while he is running are, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the defense of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and fell." Does this seem odd to anyone? Perhaps David is not aware that his life is on the line. Maybe David doesn't have a grasp of what's happened. Maybe he's had some lunacy that has taken over his mind where he is not aware of his surroundings. How could David be in the midst of an assassination attempt and still declare, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear?" In fact, maybe we should ask, how is it that we could be under those types of pressures and still be able to boldly declare that when the wicked and my enemies try to come to me to eat of my flesh, they will stumble and fall? I believe that there are three things that David has been able to do that if we were to incorporate them, would also help us not to get bent out of shape. Number one, David has remembered the victories of the past. This is the David who, as a boy, is sent out as a messenger to see of his brother's well-being. And the Bible lets us know that when David gets there, he hears a voice calling out over the land. It is the voice that he has never heard before, the voice of Goliath. The Bible lets us know that as he hears Goliath, he looks around at his brothers and all of the other soldiers who are gathered, and he is puzzled because he does not understand why no one has shown this Goliath what really needs to be shown. Why have nobody gone out there to Goliath and really quieted this man down? The Bible says he goes to Saul, and as he talks to Saul about what needs to be done, he begins to recall for Saul how God had delivered him in the past. As a young boy, he says that there were lions and bears that tried to take my sheep, and the God of heaven gave me enough power to kill the lion and the bear. And the same God who gave me the power to kill the lion and the bear will give me the victory over Goliath. And with that faith, that statement, not a word from God. He didn't go out and fast and pray. He didn't need to assemble the prayer warriors or a team. He knew that because God had powered him in the past, that the same God would give him power in the future. And the God that he spoke his faith in, the one who he rehearsed the goodness of, that same God gave him the victory over Goliath. Just because he was able to talk about the goodness of God, not just what he hoped for in the future, but he recalled the things in the past. And I wonder here today, what would happen for us as we go through our hardships if we just took a moment to remember what God did for us in the past? If we could remember how God kept us in the meeting in the past, when our relationship was on the rocks, how God gave us wisdom and discernment in the past, when we were out of money and we didn't know how to get new funding, how God sent funding from heaven in the past, and maybe our stress levels would be dissipated, if our anxiety would be healed, if we just took a moment to remember what God had already done for us. Look, so David is able to withstand the threat of Saul because he remembers the victory with Goliath. He remembers how God strengthened his hand and gave him the victory. And so now he can stand tall. He can not be bent out of shape because the God who did it for him in the past is still here with him in the present. Oh my goodness. He remembers the victories of the past. He also rests in the goodness of God in the present. It's interesting to me how there are times where we forget how much of God's goodness is responsible for us being here right now. That we are here because of the mercy of God. If we just think about how many people did not wake up this morning, how many individuals found themselves in adverse situations today, how many people are in the midst of foreclosure and things today, and when we just look over the landscape, I'm not talking about yesterday, I'm not talking about tomorrow, but when I just think about today, that in 2020, February the 15th, that God has spared my life today, that he has moved things together, that my car started this morning, that I was able to get out of my bed unassisted, that God allowed me to have clothes to wear today, that I have the presence of mind to be in his house on a Saturday morning in order to worship with people. When I just think about how much of God's goodness is involved with me today, then I realize that God did not allow me to be in this pretty dress and to have my hair done to come here to leave me. That if God allowed me to get to this point, then he's going to help me to get over the hump that's ahead of me. Just think about how many medications that some other people are taking, and you might be taking one less, praise the Lord. You think about how much assistance that other people have needed, and they're unable to walk for themselves, or unable to care for themselves. But somehow at your age, and with all that has happened in your life, God still brought you here today? Now, it becomes compounded when we start to think about how much we do not deserve it. There are people who have lived better lives than I have, who have suffered more than I have. But the reason why I'm here today is not because of my goodness, not because of anything that I have done or achieved, but it is of the mercy of God. The Bible says it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. His compassion fails not. It's new every morning. Great is God's faithfulness. So when I think about the fact that that me standing in the Madison Campus Church today is an act of God's mercy, then I can trust God to keep me through this sermon and the next sermon on today. I can trust God to keep me as I am dealing with difficulties as a pastor. I can trust God to keep me and to give me direction as a wife. I can trust God to keep me and to give me direction as a stepmother. I can trust God to help me through my issues and my tests. And I want to share with you that secondly, if we would just rest in God's goodness in the present, and that God has already given us power and strength for today, then we wouldn't try to take on our difficulties by ourselves. We would know that it is only God's mercy that has kept us here. When we think about David has endured several assassination attempts. He has endured the lion, the bear. He has endured the giant. He is still there. And even though he is a fugitive, he has still received the mercy of God. Oh, I'm sorry. I know I'm in Madison Campus, but I just got to be happy for this moment because he survived all of the other things. It's just God's mercy keeping me even in my hardship, even in my test. They are messing with me at my job, but thank God I have a job. The relationship is difficult, but thank God I have a relationship. My kids are on my nerves, but thank God I have kids. God has still been merciful to me. Even though my circumstance is not rosy. Now, I want to tell you today, I want to share with you today that no matter how difficult your life is when you leave here, the fact that you have life is an act of the mercy of God. He has not forgotten about you. He has not forsaken you. He has not left you. He is with you right now. David is able to rest in the goodness of God in the present. Because he knows that God has been faithful to him in the past, and it is God keeping him in the present. Now he is able to receive the promise of God for the future. It's difficult being tied in time, isn't it? We want to know how the market and the futures are going to go next week. We want to know how the relationship will shake out next month or next year. We want to know that our child is going to finally come back home, that they're going to make good decisions in the future, that what we have taught them will not be lost. We want to know what the future is. And I promise you today, I would give everything I had if there was a machine that some of you scientists could create to help me to see with accuracy what tomorrow holds. Wouldn't you give some good money in order to know with accuracy what next week will be like? But we don't have that ability yet. However, we do have a God who is not bound by time. We have a God who sees the whole board. He knows what will happen next week and next month, and he is giving us wisdom and discernment to accurately move so that we will be correctly positioned next week for what it is that will come. I mean, have you ever been in a scenario where you have remembered all of the different steps and turns that your life have taken, and even though those moments were marked with frustration because you didn't like how it felt to be in those predicaments, you realize today that all of the things that you have gone through in the past have actually lined you up for where you are right now. Like, have you ever just looked over the landscape of the last 10 years and see how God has strategically allowed you to meet with people and strategically allowed you to have opportunities that have lined you up and given you the wisdom and discernment for what you needed right now? So this is the thing that I want to share with you. You don't have to know what tomorrow holds because you know who holds tomorrow. You don't have to know what next year will be like because you have a person who is residing in next year. So here is David, and he is speaking with faith about what God will do, not because he knows what the timeline is, but because he knows the person who is plotting the timeline. He knows that as long as he stays with God, that God will lead him in the way that he needs to go. He is declaring in faith that although Saul and Absalom have the best of him, and in this moment, that they will not ultimately win. They will give him oppression in these moments, in these seconds, in these hours, in these days. But when the whole story is told, that God will come through. And I want to say today that the way that we endure, the way that we are able to successfully navigate not knowing the future, is having faith in God that he will protect our future. He will not allow us to ultimately fall. He will not allow us to be defeated. He will not allow us to fail. That the God of heaven loves us enough. He is too wise to err and too kind to do any unkind thing to those who walk uprightly. That God is good. But in order to be able to look toward the future with calm, we have to believe that God is good. So the question that we ask in this moment is, are you sure that God is good? Do you believe that he will keep his word? Do you believe that his promises don't fail? Because if you don't know that God is good, you're not sure that his promises won't fail, then you have to depend on what Congress or what the pastoral team or what the manager at your job will do. You have to depend on people in order to be calm if you don't trust that God is good. I'm not sure about you. I haven't been in Nashville for a little while, but I haven't had much success trusting my future to people. That has not worked out well for me. People fail. And maybe not you, but people have failed me. There have been moments where people have made promises and they have not come through for me. I realize that that is too much trust to put in people. But David says he's not looking to people to be his assurance and his strength. He says, the Lord is my light. The Lord is my salvation, so I don't have to fear anyone. David ultimately sees both Saul and Absalom defeated. It takes some time. It requires some people that he loved to be moved out of his life's frame. But ultimately, David is victorious. And throughout his hardship, he is able to successfully see the victory of God because he does not lose his faith. My brother, my sister, you want to be like my super hair tie that doesn't bend out of shape when stretched? Then the secret is wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Today, you find yourself in a scenario that is stretching you. Whether it's family or your health, maybe it's your finances, and you need God to give you that kind of faith, that resilience that will keep you through the hardship, I'm going to ask you to stand. I need that kind of faith that'll keep me through all of it. We're going to pray together. Lord, we are grateful that there is an antidote to being stressed out and stretched out. That antidote is faith in you. And as we stand here today, you know all of the concerns that are here in this house. Everyone who is calling out to you in their secret moments. The questions that were even raised through my presentation, wondering whether or not you truly could be trusted to get them out of this. Perhaps they said, the preacher doesn't know my circumstance. She doesn't see how long I have been praying for this. She doesn't know the whole story. And that is true, God. But we rest assured that you know. You know everything we've been facing. You've heard every conversation. You know the past, the present, and the future. And so, we entrust our stories to you today. God, we ask you to be the one who leads us safely forward. I pray that in the meantime, that the joy of the Lord would be our strength. That you would strengthen our heart and give us, O Lord, the fortitude to be able to withstand everything that comes against us. And in the end, we know that we will see your goodness in the land of the living, is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
To stay and listen to the organ, but this concludes our service. We're so glad that you've been here today. I don't know about you, but Pastor Johnson spoke to my heart. So thank you so much. And God bless you. Have a great Sabbath. Enjoy your Sabbath schools.